Hello everyone, it's my pleasure to start this behind the scenes conversation with Raghava Rao, VP of Finance and CFO of Amazon India. In inviting Raghava to this episode, I want to highlight why for every founder and any startup, having the right finance partner in building out your business vision is the most critical hire, and usually it's a hire that's not well thought through or put off for too long. And those are some of the points we will discuss today. Welcome, Raghava. Thanks for taking this time.
Thank you, Vani. Thank you for having me for your podcast.
Raghava, the first question I had for you is, the world in both of our careers and journeys has gone from being largely analog to mostly digital. And in your function from a finance professional perspective, how has that changed?
Let me break down the answer into two parts. First are the changes that have happened in the what I would call the backyard to a finance professional, essentially finance processes that the finance professional completely owns. There, I think the answer is there's a lot of automation that has happened. A good example is accounting, which some time back used to take up a lot of time and judgment, is now completely automated. And complex decisions are left to an SME. So that's one area where things have changed. If I take the second part, that the role that a finance professional plays as a business partner to a business head, I think what has changed through digitization is the fact that there's a lot more information and data that is available for a firm to get more efficient. We've all heard the quote that data is the new oil. But the second part of that quote is pretty important, that what differentiates firms is who has a better analytics, which is really the combustion engine for processing all of that data. And I think that is something where things have really changed. So processing that data, analyzing it to draw insights out of it, converting those insights into action, and then moving from action to prediction. That's the transition that I think digitization has brought about in the role of finance as a finance professional, is what I've seen in the last 10 years or so.
I want to ask you, from your perspective, how do you see the role of finance team in a very early stage company?
I think you're right. Having a good finance partner in the early stage of a startup is sometimes underestimated, and it can make a lot of difference. What a good finance partner does at the early stage of a startup is to help connect the dots and draw the line between what the startup is today versus what it should be in the future, let's say 5 years later, 10 years later, etc. And the way the finance partner does it is firstly understanding what the startup is all about. And the startup is all about its culture, about the product, about the missionary zeal that the promoters have. And it is about obsession with customers. And what a good finance partner can do is take all of these and then map out what the business will look like 5 years from now if you were all successful. What your cash flows would look like, what your cost structure would look like, what your revenue streams would look like, and therefore what mechanisms and what processes you should have. And then break out the gap between here and now and there and future into a series of milestones, which you then agree with the promoter or the startup's team about making those progression and checking in at regular intervals. They could be 3 months, 6 months, 1 year, or funding infusion, but checking in that are we making the progression to the financial future that we have all co-created. I think that's really the important role that a finance person does to steer the team in the right direction. And the way you would do that is to build the emphasis around controllership, build the emphasis around cost structures and cash flows, without losing the core part of what keeps a startup going, which is its missionary zeal, the product is hero, and the customer obsession part of it. So having a good finance partner sort of helps you get started and move in the right direction and have a guide for the destination that you need to get there.
What is your advice to founders on at this early stage? How should they think about, KPIs? How should they think about their business metrics on what they focus on? Because the balance sheet by itself may not be relevant in terms of the criticality.
For a startup at the early stage, and for all the right reasons, like I said earlier, the product is indeed the hero, and customers are indeed key. And it's very important to make sure that the focus of the promoters or the small startup team is on measuring the non-financial numbers. But the non-financial numbers, to a large extent, should be focused on customers, customer adoption, customer loyalty, customer retention, customer attrition, and measuring customer engagement. And of course, different businesses and different products have different ways of measuring all of this. So these are absolutely the right metrics to measure. What the finance person should do and what the promoters should allow the finance person to do is to connect these non-financial metrics, these what I would call business first principle KPIs, with the second principle KPIs, which is your cash flows, your costs, your revenues, the size of your balance sheet, and see how they're going to play out. And use these second principles to validate and make sure that your customer engagement is moving in the right direction and that your scale that you've got is allowing you to generate or reduce your negative cash flows and sort of move to positive cash flows over a period of time. So continue to stay focused on the first principles of looking at customer metrics, because that's the best way to measure how your product is really doing. But step back and make sure that you have some connect between these metrics and your cash flows, because as your startup becomes larger and a little bit more complex, some of these second principle metrics are going to become pretty important. And the transition has to be fairly seamless between the customer metrics and the financial metrics, and both will need to go hand in hand. They can't be divorced. And that's really the challenge and what the promoters should allow the finance person to do. And the finance partner in a startup really has this role to play.
And you have led many M&A and financing discussions in your career, many, many. Advice for someone, the founders that are on the other side of the table?
I think, of course, an M&A can be of two types. It can be a big bang exit, or it can be, of course, a strategic equity infusion. And I think there are some things which are common and similar between both of them. I think for the first time, it's important to think of an exit not just as an end of a beautiful story, but it could possibly be the beginning of another beautiful story for the promoter. So the promoter has to be very willing and very okay with sort of exiting at the right stage. That's one. The second thing is, and I heard this from an investment banker, and I sort of saw this play out in my own experience. It's like what matters most in a transaction can be summarized. It's a little bit like physics, chemistry, and maths, but the sequence is chemistry first. So when you're looking to exit or an M&A deal, is the chemistry the right chemistry between what you as a promoter feel and about the person at the other end? So the chemistry has to click, and nothing will make sense if the chemistry doesn't click. Mm-hmm. The second part is the physics of the transaction. So is it an asset deal? Is it an entire sort of sellout of equity? Or are you going to carve out some assets and liabilities and do this as a block deal? I think the physics of the transaction has to really make sense. And of course, last comes in the math, as in on the numbers. So that's the sequence in which I think a promoter should think about an M&A deal: the chemistry, the physics, and the maths part of it. And on the other hand, if it is just an equity infusion, I think what comes to the table along with just equity in terms of the pedigree of the partner that you are signing up for to be part of your journey for the next few years is really important. I would recommend that a lot of emphasis be given to the pedigree of the partner and not just the extent of cash flows that is coming in as something that is going to make a lot of difference. The advice that you would get, the track record that investor has, and the kind of expectation and relationship that you will build with that promoter over the next few years, I think can be as much of value as the cash that is coming in because you're selling out a part of your transaction. So that's what I would tell the promoters to really think hard about when they make their choice.
Raghava, in your 26 years of working career in many roles, many organizations, I have a two-part question for you. What do you look for in leaders that you have chosen to work with? What do you look for in people that you hire into your team?
Yeah. A great question, Moni, and I get asked this question quite often, and so I've indeed reflected upon it. The qualities that make up for a great leader, in my view, are probably three things. First is whether this person as a leader breeds a culture of excellence around him or her. I would also call it the ability to insist on high standards. Does this person every day that they come in into office or to work take decisions or actions to make sure that by the end of the day, things that have been done are done in a way which is slightly better than what they were done last time, yesterday, day before yesterday, or so on, is, I think, really important. These small changes, if a leader is able to drive, the compounding effect of these small changes in terms of improvements around the person are pretty significant over a certain period of time. So the ability to insist on high standards and do so consistently is leadership quality number one. Leadership quality number two is the quality of judgment around decisions. Very often, every day a leader has to face decisions. You also have to make a choice whether the speed of the decision is important or the quality is important. You have to make a decision about how much of data do you need for that decision, or are you okay with just trusting your gut and instinct? And there are times when you need to keep the data aside and go with what your gut says. And the ability to do so consistently is, I think, what sets aside a second leader, and I would call it the ability to be to deliver good judgment is I think, quality number two. Quality number three, in my view, is just this ability to stay humble, keep learning, and be curious about the world outside them. We do live in an era where things outside are changing very rapidly in technology, in terms of regulations, in terms of competition, etc. And a leader who may perhaps be frozen in his or her head can do a lot of damage versus a leader who's able to relax his or her points of view, assimilate new inputs from the external world, and change their decisions in the right way. And I think that ability to learn new things is also very contagious. And that, I think, is a third important quality. And linking all of this is just this track record of when faced with difficult situations, does a leader demonstrate grit and resilience in being able to go through crisis? And how do they take their decisions under crisis, I think is really sort of important. Similarly, if I were to look for a finance person, I would, it's not really different from the first answer. I would look for each of these. Does the person have the ability to keep learning? Does the person have the ability to take decisions? Does the person have the ability to keep sort of getting better day in and day out? Is what I would sort of look at. And specific to finance, I think the ability to earn trust, to have a backbone when you interact with your business partners, and a basic sense of integrity is, I think, sort of important. And I think one of my favorites is always, does a person learn well from the failures that they've had before? Because that's always very important. You're not going to be successful in everything that you do, but an ability to learn from failures and be able to connect the dots, I think, becomes really important. So these are the things that I would sort of look for. And all of this must fall into the fact that from a culture point of view, the person you hire has to fit in very well into the core culture of the organization. You can make a mistake if you hire a very bright person, but if you think that bright person is not going to fit in into your culture, you're probably better off by not hiring that person. So that's the way I would sort of look at Tawani in terms of hiring, as well as qualities in the business leaders that I would sort of work with.
One other nuanced question, Raghava. Yeah. For example, when I have invested in a company and I accept to be on their board, there are two actually very different roles. I am a shareholder. I'm also a board member. Generally, they both may mean the same thing, but there are circumstances and situations where they don't mean the same thing. Those are two different roles. And the only other person in the company that applies to is also the finance person, because yeah, while they report to the CEO or managing director, in a way, they also report dotted line to the board. And most of the time, there may be no conflict, but yeah, there is a nuance there. And can you comment on that? Because it is something that's not as well understood and as well set up, even by the finance professional themselves. So I'd love for you to comment on this for the benefit of younger companies.
Yeah, I think what you're pointing out is the conflict that sometimes comes in for a CFO between serving the interests of the business leader versus serving the interests of the shareholder. By the way, that's not just for a CFO, but any finance partner always has their dilemma, and I call this the dilemma between serve and protect. You have to serve somebody, right? You serve your business partner that you're partnering with. You serve that person, and by making that person successful, you become successful. That's the serve part of it. But there is also an aspect of controllership and protection. Sometimes you have to protect the business because you have the stewardship. You have the keys to the treasury, just to put it very crudely. And sometimes you have to protect the long-term interests of the business from what the promoter might want to say or do. And I think managing this conflict is sometimes pretty important. And it, of course, depends on the individuals who are there. But I think when you discuss with shareholders, sometimes, and I think this is where your sense of integrity and professionalism comes in, as to how do you make these trade-offs, if at all, between the serve part of your role and the protecting the long-term interests part of your role. And there can be specific situations, but a CFO has to know which way he or she is leaning at any point of time. And I think that becomes really important. And I think your moral compass, your integrity, and your sense of professionalism is what really matters a lot. And I would say that, I don't want to advocate one for the other, but there are different situations where these things matter, and you should be guided by what your moral compass and your integrity is.
Raghav, I can't thank you enough for these very valuable insights and perspectives that you took the time out to share with us today, and really appreciate it. And stay safe, everyone. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Vani, and thanks for inviting me to your podcast.